Hello, BookTube. It's Tag Tuesday, and I have a tag I want to do that I was tagged in by Una and Krypto, the guys at Codex Cantina. There are many other tags that are floating around that all look great, and also I have a backlog of tags that I haven't done, but I thought this took precedence. It's the I Want to Believe tag, and it was created by Rajathon, and I will leave a link to his channel. His channel's fantastic, so are the guys at Codex Cantina. And the fact that I would say that about them when I don't agree with much of what they read just goes to show you the kind of that a lot of the stuff that you hear about the community on BookTube is true. They had some precious quotes in their own version of Rajaslan's tag. Crypto said, "I think everybody should grow a beard," which prompted me to say to the screen the admonition that I've been saying to young men, and I consider both of these guys very young, for a long time, basically since I mustered out of the army of Alexander the Great, which is that facial hair on young men is inherently ridiculous. So when you say, "I think everybody should grow a beard," what you should do is immediately change that to, "I don't think anybody should grow a beard." Once you're 50, okay, maybe. Young? No. No. And these huge, gigantic, John Brown's body type sternum length beards that young men are growing these days as a fashion, get rid of it all. You don't have any idea how ridiculous you look. But he was not to be outdone. Una, in addition to doing this tag, made a special challenge for me personally. he said at one point, I don't know if this is going to catch on, he said that when it comes to me, tag, there should be a slight handicap, a slight extra on tag requests to compensate for the fact that I've been reading for all of my 28 years. But his extra challenge was that I should include in some of my answers references to the X-Files comic book that was made. And I wanted to point out, again, to the screen, I wanted to point out that Mulder and Scully are mid-level United States government bureaucrats. They don't wear spandex, and neither one of them is from Krypton. They aren't bulletproof, so I don't have comic books about them. Why on earth would I buy a comic book about two people in suits who work in an office? Why would I do that? So I'm going to have to pass on the extra challenge. But the questions themselves are all about the X-Files. They're all about the great TV show, the X-Files. And naturally, each question is prompted by a specific episode, and naturally, as an X-Files fan, I'm looking at the list and thinking, "Oh well, I wish this episode had been on there. I wish that one." But largely, it's a great list, and it starts with the pilot, which I remember watching. I had no idea, like everybody else at the time, all of the TV fans at the time, I doted on the fall preview issue of TV Guide. Oh my, it was pre-internet, and it was an amazing, tantalizing look at the upcoming roster of shows. I would look at each page was devoted to a show, and I would look at those and try and guess which one of these is going to be a hit. And I don't remember thinking much of the X-Files at all, but I loved the show, absolutely loved it. I remember the exact moment when I realized, because you know the premise is only one thing, the people involved have to be firing on all cylinders. They have to have been given the green light from the executives running the show to be extra creative, to do whatever they want, run an idea by us, and we won't shoot it down. And I remember the exact moment when I realized that the X-Files was in the hands of such showrunners, because there was an episode about out-of-control insects, and at one point in the episode, a bug crawls up the screen sideways, designed to make everyone watching the show bolt out of their chair and run to their TV, because it looked like there was a bug crawling across the screen, but it was actually added by the show without any explanation. It wasn't part of the plot. It was explicitly breaking the fourth wall to make you jump in your seat, and it worked. That's why I fell in love with the show. But the prompt for pilot is a great beginning to a series or trilogy. And here I'm going to mention a book that I've mentioned before. It's S.M. Sterling's novel Dies the Fire. I want to recommend it one more time as part of a series that has been informally called the Emberverse series. And the series it gets wilder and weirder and probably to most people less satisfying as it goes along, and it goes along for a long time. But that first book is pure magic, just pure magic, where an event happens that is called the Change. No one can understand it. There is no explanation that's ever given in the series. There's a flash of light in everyone's mind, in everyone's brain, and when it's over, it's just a fraction of a second. When it's over, no higher technology works. Planes fall out of the sky, cars don't ignite, even gunpowder flashes for a second and then dies down. The chemical balances have been changed so that advanced technology of any kind doesn't work. And suddenly the world is thrown into medieval level technology. Do you use horses? Do you use water power? Do you have to learn how to use arrows? You have to, and later on in the series, the characters take advantage of abandoned train tracks to use a kind of hand pump trestle that they can move around in faster, a kind of automation. And society falls apart. So it has to be built back together. People have to group together for their common goals and their common life philosophies. And it's terrific. It really is terrific. I had a few problems with the first book. The series has often been mocked as with the phrase "and the geek shall inherit the earth," because suddenly the geekiest people in the world are suddenly finding that their knowledge of how to build for a 13th century arrowhead is useful, and it's a little bit unbelievable how many of those people there are and how many of them are in one small area, Willamette Valley. And also I had a problem because there, in most of the books in the series, we get bears, we get mountain lions, we get tigers and lions and whatnot, but there's hardly ever any mention of feral dogs when they would be the number one thing. They would be everywhere. And it took the ancestors, the evolutionary ancestors of dogs, very little time, less than a generation, probably, to domesticate, to realize if we hang around these weird beings, some of them will chase us away, but some of them will welcome us. And if we prove our worth and they prove theirs, this is a partnership, and they have fire and they waste a lot of food. It didn't take long for dogs to do that. And my point in saying that is it wouldn't take long for them to undo it either. overall, the series is incredible. I love the whole of the series. Not everybody does. Most people don't. But the first book, oh my, highly recommend. Then prompt number two is Squeeze. Rajathon specifies that Toombs, the villain in that show, is his favorite monster in the series. Toombs is this creepy, bug-eyed guy who is able to squeeze himself through almost any space. And the end of the episode is amazing because it was, I don't know why I'm getting the agents' names, I'm melding the agents' names. Fox Mulder and Dana Scully. I should just say that way, although it seems wrong to say Fox Mulder, because as Mulder tells Scully at one point in one episode, even his parents called him Sculder. called him Mulder. No one calls him Fox. but I'm getting their names wrong, so I maybe will use the two of them. But at the end of the episode, after they've caught Toombs and he's in prison, we see him in his prison cell, and a guard comes up and slides his meal tray through the slot in the door and leaves it open by mistake. And we see Toombs on his cot in his cell, and he's just looking at the food tray because it's so impossibly thin. Can he actually fit through there? Can he actually do it? Anyway, the prompt is, what is your favorite monster in a book? And for me, this is fairly easy. It's Robert Moses in Robert Caro's book, The Power Broker. Another huge book, a big, fat biography of just a horrible, brusque despoiler with delusions of godhood. Someone who took a sledgehammer to a whole bunch of vital communities and called it art. Caro doesn't try really hard to rehabilitate his reputation in the course of the book. That's what makes it such beguiling reading. I wish I had a copy of The Power Broker. I actually don't. I checked when I was thinking about it for this tag. But I strongly recommend it. It's big, but I strongly recommend it. Especially since if you live in America, in the Northeast, you're living in the wreckage of Robert Moses, more than likely. In Boston, we certainly are. Then let's see here. Prompt number three is the ErlenMeyer Flask. The one where they find an alien baby. What is the best science fiction novel you have ever read? The best science fiction... I immediately had two answers for this. Best in terms of, critically, what I do for a living, would be Dune by Frank Herbert. But Favorite wouldn't. I mean, I love Dune. It's one of those books where it's not just critically revered. I also personally revere it. I absolutely love it. But probably if we want to use a broad brush for a definition of science fiction, then probably my favorite book is 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea by Jules Verne. Probably that is. Even I know that it's a hipster response because it's, you know, I liked him before he was cool, or, you know, I haven't liked anything in the last 100 years or whatever. And there's plenty of science fiction that I love. I've talked about plenty of science fiction on this channel, but 20,000 Leagues does it for me in a way that I don't find it particularly easy to explain, but I nevertheless, that so it's best or favorite there for me. And then prompt number four is Clyde Bruckman's Final Repose. A great, great episode in which Peter Boyle plays a man who can tell how people will die. He has the psychic ability to predict how people will die. That's all. He can't predict anything else. He predicts how people will die. And it's amazing. It's just an amazing job. Rajathon points out it's the only episode that ever won an Emmy. Well deserved. And the question is simple. What is your favorite book? And mine is, and I've given this answer many times on this channel, it's The Metamorphoses by the Roman poet Ovid. That is my favorite book. prompt number five is Jose Chung's From Outer Space, a funny abduction episode. What is the funniest book that you've ever read? This top spot changes for me on a regular basis. Humor just works that way in my mind. It's perishable. So the last really funny book that I've read is usually my answer to this question. When it changes, the next really funny book that I read will take the spot. Right now, it's Cold Comfort Farm by Stella Gibbons, which I just recently reread because of my Daily Penguin, and I was cracking up a lot. there is so much brilliant, brilliant viciousness in that book. So funny. And there's so much of it that it's just tossed off. It's overflowing in all directions. It's not just the main sarcasm, the main parody of the plot that is so pitch perfect. It's all the rest of it. All the asides are wonderful too, even right down to the names. So I'm gonna give it to Cold Comfort Farm this time. If I do this tag next year, I would have different answers. Then prompt number six is Home. This episode was very disturbing and was never re-aired on TV. And if you've ever seen it, you'll know why. You'll know why. It has some humor in it, including a reference to Babe, to the movie Babe, about the little pig. But I watched it when it first aired, and I did not, even by the second commercial break, which those of you who live in the 21st century and binge your stuff on Netflix and whatnot will not know what that means. But once upon a time, there were things called commercial breaks. There were four of them. And by the second commercial break of that episode, I was thinking, God, are they trying to get this thing canceled? Are they trying to get parent groups to write in? Even at the very beginning, the opening, the teaser before the credits is the grossest thing you'll ever see. And it goes on from there. Quarter after the thing was done, you know, commercials used to break a show up into quarters, and every single 15 minutes had something in it that was more mind-bogglingly, deeply, unnervingly chilling than before. There's a brutal, brutal murder. There's a horrible group of characters at the center of the story. Extremely well done. But I understand why it's never been aired again. But anyway, I knew this was going to cause me to go on about the X-Files itself. What is the most disturbing thing that you have ever read? This also changes a lot, depending on what I'm concentrating on or what I'm thinking about at the moment. For me, the answer that came to mind here is Ed Finn's book, What Algorithms Want, which is not designed to be scary. The author's not trying to do that. But in the course of the book, I realized in the course of the book, that, in fact, I think I said it out loud when I was reading it. You realize in the course of the book that you're not reading about advances in technology. You're reading about the birth of a new life form. No exaggeration, no hyperbole. You're learning about something that knows what it is and wants to learn and will take any opportunity to learn things it hasn't been programmed to learn. There's an eagerness. If AI specialists didn't want to use terms like that, they would. They're leery of anthropomorphizing, but nevertheless, I don't think you can call it anything else. When you have a translation program that he's translating from Thai to English. And then you have another, you hook that into another translation algorithm that is translated from English to French, and you leave that link in place, and then down the line, only a very short time, you realize that the algorithm that's translating from English to French now knows Thai. When you didn't tell it to learn the language, and you didn't know that it was eavesdropping, and it's creepy. In a kind of, you know, the singularity is near type of way, because I don't think, I know that caution is usually the watchword in books about AI and smart technology, that kind of thing, and I agree with that, but I don't think that we have any idea what we're doing. I really don't think that human AI engineers have any idea what they're doing. I think they're so blindly concentrated on what they can do, that they're not paying attention to the fact that they don't really know the end game. And that worries me. That scares the crap out of me. So I'm going to, especially since it scares the crap out of me, because it's responsible for everything now. Smart technology is responsible for everything now. It's everywhere. We've let it be everywhere, thinking, assuming that we would always have control over it and that we would always know what it was doing. And I don't think either one of those assumptions are true. And if there are 10 locked out systems that run, for instance, the nuclear reactor on a U.S. destroyer or a nuclear power plant somewhere in the American West, there are 10 systems that are locked out from each other that work together to run that facility. Humans can have almost no effect on any of those things if even two of them stop working or start working in a different way than they were programmed. And there have been all sorts of simulations. I read a simulation in a big book by a military AI expert. There have been all sorts of simulations that show that there is no such thing as locking out those systems. They can talk to each other, and we don't know what they would say. And that's the situation right there. One of those systems decides, if you want to use the word decide, cascades into a decision where they launch missiles from a nuclear vessel in the South China Sea, that's the end of the world. And it wouldn't have any humans involved. And this is the thing, that is what scared me for the moment for this question. Then prompt number 7 is Postmodern Prometheus. This is a black and white Frankenstein style episode. What is your favorite classic book? And unlike perhaps the majority of BookTube, I've already given that answer because I don't draw a distinction. Favorite book is favorite book, and my favorite book is work of classical Greece and Rome. It is The Metamorphoses by the Roman poet Ovid, so that's, I'm just going to double up on that answer. Then prompt number 8 is Bad Blood. In this episode, Mulder kills a vampire, or thinks he does, and then tells the story all in flashbacks. What is your favorite way they use flashbacks to tell a story? And there are many, many examples of this that I could give, but I think the one that came to mind when I was answering this is The Goldbug Variations by Richard Powers. Fantastic novel, incredibly moving, that has some incredibly moving long flashback sequences in it that I really need to reread The Goldbug Variations. I don't have a copy at the moment. I keep thinking that sooner or later somebody's going to bring out a nice collection of Powers and that it will be one of them. But probably if I were to find a nice UK trade paperback with The Goldbug Variations, I would get it and reread it, because I'm long overdue for a reread. Then prompt number 9 is Drive. A man jumps into Mulder's cart, and they speed off through the entire episode. What is a book that you have read that is a non-stop ride? This is tough to do. This is a tougher question than you might think, because even really non-stop books have slow patches. A lot of them do. And also for me, it isn't just a slow patch that is a stop. For me, a stop could also be an annoying tick on the part of the author. Something where the pace of the story isn't slowing down at all, but I am still slowing down because I'm so annoyed with the author. Perfect example of that would be The Martian by Andy Weir, which under most circumstances, in most considerations, would certainly be called a non-stop novel. But it's so jingly and slangy, so relentlessly so, that it bugged me. So the example I came up with is also science fiction, is Neuromancer by William Gibson, which is largely considered one of the foundational, what's the word for it? what's gone right out? Cyberpunk. One of the foundational cyberpunk novels, along with Islands in the Net and whatnot. One of the things that its prescience and its trailblazing way that Gibson writes it is the stuff that tends to get it attention. And what tends to be forgotten, I think, about it is how good it is, how well written it is. And it is extremely kinetic. It hardly ever slows down at all. Again, that is another book that I don't have, and it's another book that I am very much in the mood to reread. Very much so. Let's see here. Number 10 is Milagro. This episode of book becomes reality when the author writes it. What is a book setting you would never want to go to? Of course, the first thing I thought when I read the prompt is The Lathe of Heaven by Ursula Le Guin, in which the main character, George Orr, has dreams that rewrite reality. And he becomes aware of it right around the same time that the therapist he was sent to becomes aware of it. And his therapist is not thinking of curing a patient. His therapist is thinking, the greatest weapon in the history of the universe has just walked into my office. I can surely use this to do lots of good, but in a fascistic way. I am the one who will determine what the good is. But in terms of a book with setting you never want to go to, it's a recent one for me. It's by Holden Reed. It's called Scourge of War. It's not out yet. I think it comes out next month. And it's or maybe later than that. The date may have been pushed back. It's a biography of William Tecumseh Sherman and a book about his march to the sea. It's mainly a military history of his scorched earth campaigns during the American Civil War. And I'm having lots of issues with it, as I predicted that I would. And all I'm thinking while I'm reading it, the whole time I'm thinking, how horrible it must be to be in a quiet little suburb, a quiet little town, well off the main roads, well off the railroad junctions, in the gentle hand of a wooded hollow somewhere in Georgia, just working your own small farm, going to market every week or so, raising your children, sending them to a nearby one-room schoolhouse, never thought of owning a slave, didn't have any say in leaving the Union, don't think about it at all, too busy minding your place and growing your crops and raising your children. How horrible it must be to be in a situation like that and realize, sometimes by feeling it in the ground, that a massive army is coming. And you don't have a car, there are no cars, there are no subways or anything like that. You're just stuck. The army rides up, they want everything you have. You're lucky if all they do is take all of your food. You're lucky if all they do is bivouac all of their men in your yards and in your house. It could be a lot worse than that. There are unspeakable things that could and did often happen. And there's nothing you can do. There's nowhere you can go. That is a circumstance. In the path of Sherman's army is not a place I would want to be at all. A bonus question, which is it's a line from the Bare Naked Ladies 1 week, where their idiotic mishmash lines where they say, I hope the smoking man is in this, about referring to an absolutely ridiculous character who recurred on the show solely because the fans wanted more of him. And I wanted to tell the showrunners, just because the fans ask for it doesn't mean you have to do it. You're doing fine. You're doing fine. You're a very popular show. You don't need to bring back an idiotic character because the fans liked him. The bonus question is, what is your favorite side character in a book? I don't see where that bonus question comes from. The Smoking Man is not a side character. He's a stupid caricature. There's nothing to him at all. He's QAnon in the flesh. But nevertheless, the question is good, and there are a million possibilities. There's one that is on my mind because of something that I'm reading. I just read an extremely advanced copy of something that who knows when it will be out. All about the Battle of the Little Bighorn. All about the last stand of George Armstrong Custer and all of his men. It's a perennially fascinating story. Just perennially fascinating. It's just the ultimate cautionary tale of American hubris. Custer was absolutely sure that there was nothing he could encounter anywhere on the plains that would give him any kind of trouble. He was absolutely sure that the the thunderous charge of a small detachment of the American army would be enough to rout anything that he would find. And so he was blinded to repeated warnings that he and his army were marching in into the arms and the territory of an absolutely vast enemy, an enemy that, that could easily crush them, even by sheer weight of numbers, to say nothing of the fact that the enemy's as armed as you are. Even by sheer weight of numbers, no chance whatsoever. You'd be crushed like a flea. And Custer ignored those warnings and was wiped out, was destroyed. And the character that always comes to mind is Captain Frederick Benteen, who was with Custer, but wasn't anything like him. Wasn't anything like Custer or his brother or any of the raving egomaniacs that Custer had along with him. He was a calm, sensible, duty-motivated guy who, right up until the very last minute, was trying desperately, from what we can piece together, trying desperately to pull this situation together and somehow get out of it. And it didn't work, but I was thinking of when I read Son of the Morning Star by Evan S. Connell, an absolutely great book about Custer and Little Bighorn. Well worth your time to find and read. An amazing book. But I've read many other books on this whole story, and in all of them, I always end up thinking of Benteen. It's hard not to think that a lot of the other people involved, especially Custer, got what they deserved. But Benteen, you think, oh no, you were taking a posting, you were following your duty, you were trying to keep your opinions to yourself, and you walked into one of the greatest massacres in American history. And you, unlike a lot of the other people with Custer, you don't want it for Benteen. You the more when you're reading these books, you kind of want him. I don't know. Anyway, for now it would be Captain Benteen, and that is it. That is the I want to believe tag, and all it's left for me to do on this Tag Tuesday is to tag people. I want to tag Rambling Raconteur. I want to tag Byways and Bookland. John Varner. A relatively new book channel, well worth your time. I'll leave a link to all these people down below. Sarah at Steeped in Books, I want to know if you love The X-Files, and I'd love to hear from any of these people. Did you watch The X-Files when it was coming out? Do you have episodes that aren't on this list that you would put on this list? Did you see Home? The episode Home. Do you know the episode that's being referred to here? Let's see here. Channel is new to me, a new BookTube channel. I don't know if he's ever done a tag. I don't actually know if he does tags, but I strongly recommend him because, boy oh boy, when he talks about books, it's great that he's on BookTube. The channel is called Ben Reads Books. I'll leave a link down below. I discovered him just the other day, and he doesn't have many videos. You can watch them all, and it's the way he talks about books. You're gonna wish that he had 100 videos. Why is it always? Why is it always the boring ones who have 3,000 videos? Probably because he has lots of other stuff to do. And that is it. And of course, Britta. Can't do a tag without tagging Britta. She has no tags in her backlog. And that is it. That is the I Want to Believe tag for this Tag Tuesday. Lots and lots of fun. So I'm gonna leave it there, but we have plenty of other bookish stuff to talk about. So I will be back. Thank you, BookTube.